Hey guys, welcome back to Rocket Science. We are going back to physics in this episode. You guys voted on Twitter and Ball Physics won the poll, so let's talk this topic through. First, we need to talk about units. The engine uses a custom unit to measure distance, the Unreal unit. You already know this unit from your camera settings. 100 height means that the camera is 100 Unreal units above the ground. If you don't want to get spoiled about the Rocket League lore, you might want to stop watching now, because I'm about to reveal the size conversion that the game uses. Alright. One Unreal unit is equal to 1 centimeter. I will be using the Unreal units in this video because the values make the most sense, but I'll put conversions on screen whenever possible. There are some boundary values in the Rocket League physics. The ball and the car both have a maximum speed at which they can go. For the car, this is 2300 Unreal units a second, and for the ball it's 6000 Unreal units a second. The maximum spin that the ball can have is also limited to 60 RPM or one full turn per second. Another important number is the gravitational acceleration. It is 650 Unreal units per second squared, which is 2/3 of the gravity on Earth. This means, while falling, the ball will increase its speed downwards by 650 Unreal units per second every second it's falling. So how does the ball behave once it's in the air? Air resistance does not work like it does in real life. Spin doesn't affect the ball at all while it's in the air. The ball does slow down, however. It will lose 3% of its speed every second, or in other words, it will halve its speed every 22 seconds. Obviously, it will never be in the air that long, so we can conclude that waiting for the ball to slow down significantly when it's in the air doesn't work. On the ground, there's some sliding friction on top of this. It slows the ball at a rate of 230 Unreal units per second squared. Because the ball can't spin faster than 1 round per second, it's not fast enough to roll without sliding unless the ball moves at a speed of less than 1 time its parameter per second, which is around 565 Unreal units. So once it gets that slow, there will be no sliding friction and the air drag gets counteracted by the rotational energy. The ball only slows down about 2.2% per second. If the ball has side spin, it will also have a much bigger impact at these low speeds. When the ball moves at a speed of less than 40 Unreal units per second for 2.5 seconds and has a spin of less than 10 RPM, it will just stop. If you can get it to spin perpendicular at a higher rate than 10 RPM, it will never stop. The horizontal speed should never reach zero either, but at some point the ball will keep the same position because of rounding errors in floating point arithmetics. Before the ball goes sliding or rolling on the floor, it will have to bounce first though. I need to clear up a common misconception right here. Many think that the angle of incidence has to be the angle of reflection on a bounce without spin, but that is unfortunately not the truth. This happens with light, but with a normal ball you have friction and strength of reflection to consider. You can split a bounce that is coming in at an angle into two different components. One is parallel and the other one is perpendicular to the wall. The physics of the latter are really easy to explain. In Rocket League, you will always get back 60% of the perpendicular momentum in a bounce. This means if the ball is coming in with a perpendicular momentum of 1000 Unreal units per second, it will have 600 Unreal units per second in the opposite direction after the bounce. Sadly, you can't calculate the parallel component this easily. Friction depends on the perpendicular force, and the spin of the ball can also affect the bounce to some degree. What will hopefully help you a lot more than a formula is explaining the general idea. Since more perpendicular force will increase friction, a shallower angle also means less friction. So if a ball is moving down the field and just barely touches the wall, the parallel speed will decrease less than it would if it bounces at a 45 degree angle. Now let's get to arguably the most important part, the car-ball interactions. The ball doesn't actually interact with the model of the car. All the cars have a separate hitbox in the shape of a rectangular cuboid. The slope of the octane is just for the looks and doesn't do anything to the ball. That's not all though. Rocket League has another anomaly that you wouldn't expect. In real physics, when the ball bounces on a surface like the car's roof, there's something called the impact normal, which is perpendicular to the surface. The ball would behave the same way it would with the wall bounce, given the angle to the impact normal. In Rocket League, the impact normal isn't perpendicular to the surface. Instead, it points from the center of mass of the car to the point of impact. This was done in order to make the hits more consistent. the real-world impact normal changes drastically on an edge, which would make those hits almost unpredictable. What does that mean for the ball though? A real-life object where every impact normal points from the center of mass to the surface is a sphere. Given an impact point on the car, we can extrapolate the position on a virtual sphere and predict the bounce based on that. Essentially, it becomes a game of pool, with the only differences being that not all the balls are the same size and the car is 10 times the weight of the ball. An implication of this is that it's impossible to have a ball resting completely still on your car. That might seem bad at first, but it's actually what gives you the control needed to balance the ball on your roof. Increasing speed, decreasing speed, and turning would usually not be possible with a flat shape. If you're new to dribbling, try to picture your car as a sphere. The balancing act is pretty much the same as two spheres stacked on top of each other. Okay, direction is one thing, but how do we hit it with the most power possible? You've probably heard somewhere that you should hit the ball with the front of your car. Why is that? The front of your car is not inherently more powerful. You can actually hit the ball with the top of your car for the exact same power. The power is determined by combining three things: the speed of the part of the car that hits the ball, the impact normal, and the center of mass of the ball. In order to get the most power, you want them all to line up. The speed of the part of the car that hits the ball going in the same direction as the impact normal and both pointing straight through the middle of the ball. Knowing this, it's pretty easy to explain why you usually want to hit the ball with the front. Say the car is traveling in the direction of its roof. If you don't get the touch on the ball perfectly above the car's center of mass, then nothing is going to line up. Because of the shape of the hitbox, the front is much more forgiving. Add to that the fact that your boost is at the end of your car and that there's no flip that goes towards your roof, and you get the reason as to why you almost never see an insanely powerful roof hit. There's another part of your car though, the wheels. They have a separate hitbox that is connected to the rest of the car. If you look at the car's model, you will see that the wheels are not in a fixed position. The same seems to be true for the hitbox. When you hit the ball with them, they work like shock absorbers, which is why wheel hits are usually very weak. Alright, that's going to be it for this video. I've decided I want to cover redirects and pinches in an extra video. If you have any further things you would like me to test regarding the ball physics, please tell me so I can add them to my list. If you want to stay up to date about the channel, please go follow my Twitter.